Hi, everybody. This is Jamie Butler from Westminster College's Great Salt Lake Institute. We're just going to look at this wonderful picture of these cool shrimp and my friend who I met about 10 years ago at Great Salt Lake, hanging out with the brine shrimp, the wild brine shrimp that she caught. So hang out while everybody enters in and then we will get started. You could get your brine shrimp kits ready. You should have either a kit that looks like this, that's a baggie, or you should have a kit that has a cool tissue culture flask and a Brainy Briny on the front of it. You know, you could take all of your supplies out and start playing with them. There's some algae in there. There is a sushi stick that you could actually bend the end of it. See where the little dotted lines are? You're going to want to bend that so it's at, it looks like an L. You can get your water ready that I know a lot of you have left water out overnight or have bottles of distilled water or spring water that are ready. Oh, good. So my friend Spencer Bagley that works at Westminster, I'm going to ask him to actually be online to put their kit on camera. So Spencer, I'm going to let you in as a panelist, and I can also email you details. That will happen later. First, I'm going to blah, blah, blah about brine shrimp. So everybody get ready for a giant brine shrimp nerd out, starting right now. You might notice that I'm like pretty crazy about brine shrimp. I even have some brine shrimp tattoos that are on my arm right now. You can see my little friends, brine shrimp, so get ready. You have two ways that you can connect with us. There is a Q&A box at the bottom that should have a yellow or a red circle around it. And there's also a chat function that's there. Chat functions are things like if you agree that brine shrimp should be the state crustacean, you might want to put that in the chat function. Questions are more, hey, am I doing this by adding the salt right first, or questions that we can answer both online or live for you. I have a ton of links and resources for you. You can go to this QR code. There's going to be lots of QR codes throughout this that you can click on and go directly to them. If you go to this links and resources, you're going to see a Google document, and there is a little section called BS in your classroom. That means brine shrimp. I think teachers might get a kick out of calling it BS in the classroom. That's where I have some links in there right now, and there will actually be more later. I know a lot of you are teachers. I saw from the registration, lots of you are teachers. If you click on this QR code or go to greatsaltlakeinstitute.org, you're going to find some teacher resources that are free. The most robust plans are, if you scroll down, you're going to see lesson plans and experiments. These have been created with teachers in collaboration with teachers who are teaching science in schools. Most of these hit the sixth through eighth grade standards. And so please feel free while we're talking to look at those. You can ask us questions at the end. Again, we're gonna set these up from 4 to 5, and we're gonna learn more about brine shrimp and Great Salt Lake. And then at 5 o'clock, we're gonna really talk to teachers about the nuts and bolts of the curriculum that Maggie Miller from Parkview Elementary is going to be sharing with us. And go Spartans, go Murray District. I am a remnant, a result of the Murray School District, so go. All of this will be recorded. It's on our Great Salt Lake Institute YouTube channel. You can click on the QR code at the top of this page to reach that. I want you to pay attention to playlists. I don't know if you know Alex Purpura from the Utah Society for Environmental Education, but she taught me to use playlists. And in that, you're going to find a playlist for brine shrimp, and this will eventually go into that playlist. So look for those there. We do have some fun exhibits that are very friendly, socially distant. One is at the Utah Museum of Fine Arts. They actually let us bring brine shrimp, this middle Winogradsky column. Winogradsky columns are one way we study the microbes of the lake. They let us bring brine shrimp into the Utah Museum of Fine Arts, which is like pretty epic. That doesn't usually happen. There's at the Natural History Museum of Utah, which is one of our partners, they have a great exhibit, Decisions Downstream, where they talked with Dr. Sarah Null, who's a watershed scientist. She paired up with artists to explore how to see river habitats. Highly encourage you going to the Utah Museum of Fine Arts, the Natural History Museum to look at that. And they're also doing a lot of really cool audio tours right now at the Natural History Museum, where you can click with your phone and learn more about the resources that they have to offer. Tonight after this is a Science on Screen, where we're talking, they're showing a film with Nichelle Nichols from Star Trek called Women in Motion, where this screen celebrity actually was able to recruit a bunch of scientists to work for NASA when there was a shortage of NASA scientists. And then the director of Great Salt Lake Institute, Dr. Bonnie Baxter, she is going to come and talk about the connection to Great Salt Lake and Mars, which is so cool. So come to that tonight if you have the energy and the time. It is in the links and resources. And finally, in May is the Great Salt Lake Bird Festival. I can't remember a time that I haven't been going to this bird festival. And this year, I get to give a talk called Old Crap, Bird Crap, and Learn Crap, the Historical Archaeology and Ecology of Great Salt Lake. And I will be presenting with Dr. Chris Merritt from the State Historic Preservation Office. So a little bit different take on Great Salt Lake and the crap that's out there. So I wanted to start this. I kind of accidentally fell into Great Salt Lake. I've been working at Great Salt Lake since 1999, and I accidentally started working out there on these little birds that are called eared grebes. Oh, there's an echo. I heard there's an echo. Does anybody else have an echo with them? Oh, Maggie doesn't hear an echo. Hey, okay, Jonathan, I think Peggy, it might be you. I'm sorry to tell you it's you. Nobody else sees it. Okay, good. So I started working, I got my first job. And even though I kind of felt like everybody else did, that Great Salt Lake was stinky and it was dead and it wasn't a great place to go to, I got my first job and I took it. And it was working on these little birds called eared grebes. And eared grebes come to Great Salt Lake in the late summer when there's lots and lots of brine shrimp in the water by millions and millions of them. You can see here there's over 5 million birds that can come to Great Salt Lake every year. They're not a particularly sexy bird. They're maybe only about this big. But sometimes they will, you know, just be covering the entire surface of the water on the Antelope Island Causeway. One year I estimated that I could see 2 million eared grebes on that causeway. And these brine shrimp come and they get so fat, they start eating brine shrimp and they get so fat and they put all of their energy into their digestive system. Every single day they eat about 30,000 brine shrimp in one day. And they molt their feathers and they lose their ability to fly. But it turns out that they eat brine shrimp. And this is one of my, I did co-write a children's book with Dr. Bonnie Baxter. And this is my favorite page out of the book. And part of it is because we had talked to biologists about the sound that they thought when the eared grebes would leave. I remember the grebes migrate to this salty lake to eat lots of brine shrimp, then leave in giant flocks. I imagine the sound of millions of birds taking all off at once, their running feet pitter-pattering against the water like raindrops falling back up into the sky. That's what John Neal, he's a biologist with the Utah Division of Wildlife Resources, talks about. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to show you that wonderful scene. Anyway, millions of eared grebes come here. They pick brine shrimp out of the water one at a time and have to eat 30,000 of them. I love this picture because we actually caught them with a gill net. And a gill net is normally what fisheries biologists use to catch fish. So there's a foamy floaty line, and then there's a line at the bottom that brings the net down. And then there are these 2-inch squares that the fish can get caught in. And it turns out that our eared grebes, that's how we catch them. And we wanted to know, because people harvest these brine shrimp that they eat, we wanted to know how much energy these brine shrimp use and if the brine shrimp harvesters were leaving enough for the eared grebes. You can see in this picture, the little bird was caught in the fishing net, and we were able to pick the net off of these birds. And then we would measure their oxygen consumption. So we used oxygen consumption to know how much energy they needed to eat. And we had all sorts of funny ways of measuring. This is an image of me hanging off the dock. And I will tell you one thing, that hanging off the dock at Antelope Island is a very scary adventure. There are millions of, they're harmless orb weaver spiders, but they're giant. And when I would hang off these docks to measure the swimming of these eared grebes, these spiders would crawl up my arms, and sometimes it would be in my hair. So this study did not come without lots and lots of scared, surprising, very distracting things that were happening to me. And of all of that study, of my first job was out there, came this paper, "The Energy Budgets for Eared Grebes on the Great Salt Lake and Implications for Harvest of Brine Shrimp." You can see this funny depiction here. If I was sitting up here, I would be by this oxygen analyzer and I would scare these birds, and I would measure how long they swam and then how much oxygen they would consume when they got back up there. Of all of that, I think this is really like interesting, fun, cool math for all of these teachers that were out there. During their peak time on Great Salt Lake, that every hour of its 7.5 hours of diving bouts, they have to recover 2 shrimp per second, or over 7,000, or sorry, 2 shrimp per second and 7,466 shrimp. So, I mean, huge, right? Like, these are huge, huge, huge numbers. So I just think that, so I fell in love with these birds. I mean, they're just so cute and they're so fun. And I got to take part in, this actually impacts management, right? Because we don't want to take too much brine shrimp off of the water for these eared grebes. And so here's our brine shrimp. Many people have seen brine shrimp. They've met them before. They're cool little, in here there are these red colors. They can vary from white to red to, sometimes I've seen blue ones. I think shrimp, just like us, they are what they eat. Sometimes they're blue, sometimes they're white. And they're pretty amazing. They can dance really great. I'm gonna get in trouble for putting that on YouTube. But brine shrimp, aside from being really great dancers, they have this really unique life cycle. So in the springtime, right about now, which is really why we're doing this activity right now, all of these little dormant cysts are hatching in the warm water that's kind of the fresh water is coming into Great Salt Lake and sitting on top of that denser salt water that's underneath it. And because those brine shrimp cysts float, they are hydrated with that fresh water, and now there's algae that's in the water, and environmental conditions are being very good for them, and they're going to hatch out and they're going to molt and they're going to grow into both male and female shrimp. Our shrimp here in Utah are sexually reproducing. Some shrimp in other places are called parthenogenic. Old world shrimp are parthenogenic, and you wouldn't see male brine shrimp in the population. I want you to notice the physiology of these shrimp. These male shrimp, they have big claspers on the top of their head that they hold on to the females with. And the females, you can tell because they have a little brood sac. Those brood sacs can hold up to 300 live young or babies live young or cysts in their brood sac. And so that's another really cool adaptation for brine shrimp, right? Is they, if environmental conditions are really, really great, they'll have live young. If it's not great, if the water is getting cold and there's not enough light, they produce these dormant cysts. And these dormant cysts, they go through this period of quiescence where that's broken by cold. So if you think about Great Salt Lake, this is wonderful, right? They lay these eggs in the fall, and even if there's a really nice, nice fall day with really great temperatures, they won't hatch. They have to have a cold snap in the middle of that winter time in order to become activated and hatch in the springtime, which really, really cool. They're small. This is actually, Ty Harrison was a professor at Westminster College, and I always use this picture because I have such fond memories of him with these brine shrimp on his finger, but they're 250 microns on average. So remember that, and you can even take your little bag of salt that's in your kit, and I want you to look in there, and it kind of seems like there's only salt in there, but you're going to start seeing little teeny tiny specks. Those are the brine shrimp cysts, and you can think of those kind of as like an M&M. So they have this hard outside shell that can't be broken by heat. It's not ruined by cold. It can be dried up. And then they have this soft embryonic center that stays viable. It can stay viable in the sediments of Great Salt Lake for over 200 years that we know of, and probably longer. If they're so small, you might be wondering, how in the heck do you catch brine shrimp cysts that are 250 microns? And it's really cool. So there's, I did work for the brine shrimp industry, which is why I love to share this with you. They have small planes that fly between 1 and 300 feet off of the surface of Great Salt Lake, and they spot these giant streaks of cysts. And the brine shrimp harvesters call these a streak, just like you would see an oil streak that's floating on the surface of the water. And those planes will call down coordinates to speedboats that race out at like 40 or 50 miles an hour on the surface of the water to go claim their territory. And they use oil containment boom, exactly the same as oil remediation technology. It's a floating plastic boom that's about 3 feet tall, and you can encircle all of those cysts. Now, those cysts that you saw on Ty's finger, those were dry. When you collect the cysts from the surface of the lake, or the eggs, it doesn't matter what you call them, eggs or cysts, you can scoop it up kind of like mud or like sand, wet sand. And they encircle those, and then they pump all of those raw cysts that have water in it, that have gunk in it, whatever it is, and they pump that into these filter bags. So these are little filter bags They're about, you don't even need to know that. They hold about 2 tons of cysts or 2,000 pounds of cysts in each one of these. So these are incredibly big boats that are working out on Great Salt Lake during all times of the year. And they even have big barges where they have food and supplies like gas and water, that those big boats, this is one of those big boats that you just saw with, you know, lots and lots of tons of brine shrimp on. That's one of those boats, just for perspective. And we harvest a lot of brine shrimp off of Great Salt Lake. And you can see, since we've been managing this in the 1980s, there's ups and downs and ups and downs. But really, since the Great Salt Lake Ecosystem Program, and which is at the Utah Division of Wildlife Resources, when they started really managing and starting to understand the biology of brine shrimp and Great Salt Lake, they've gotten very good at managing. And now we've actually optimized harvest. And I want you to see, this year was not complete. In 2020, we harvested 47 million pounds of brine shrimp cysts from Great Salt Lake. And now I've already told you how I was worried about these brine shrimp when I was doing research early in my career. And it turns out that this is actually a very healthy way to manage Great Salt Lake. And I could go on and on and on, and I'm not going to, but we are leaving, the bottom line is we leave enough brine shrimp for the birds and also for the people who are harvesting and contribute to the Utah economy every year. So very sustainable harvest that I'm very proud of. And you might wonder, why in the heck are we harvesting these brine shrimp cysts? Like, what do they do? And this is my cute little baby betta fish that is very spoiled and will only eat brine shrimp. And she won't even eat the little pellets that you put in the top of the water. So these brine shrimp are very, very healthy resource with lots of protein and lots of fat that can be fed to not just my betta fish, but also to commercial aquaculture. So a lot of the prawns and the finfish that you eat are eating baby brine shrimp, at least in the first part of their life. So we have this very cool lake that supplies, I think, 40 to 50% of the brine shrimp for commercial aquaculture. And so now we're going to start playing, because you've listened to me blab enough. I want you to get your kits out and start playing with them. You can take all of your supplies out. I'm going to ask Erica Meyer and Spencer Bagley, I'm going to give you permission to come and join us also. And so you do have different kits. Like I said, you have, some people have a little tissue culture flask. Some people have a brainy, briny beaker bag that's there. So get those out. I'm going to play some videos for you. And then Erica and Spencer and are going to demonstrate how to put these kits together. If you have any questions, please put them in the chat. Erica and Spencer, if you have questions while you're putting yours together, please tell us what they are. Okay, so here we go. Okay. The reason that I really want to watch this YouTube video is Matthew Huber is here with Algae Research Supply, and he is here to answer questions also. I wanted to show you this video so that you know this is online, that you have this resource that you can use. So here's this video from Matthew Huber with Algae Research Supply on how to put your kits up. I am going to skip around a little bit in this video so that just to save a little bit of time, just so you know.
Okay, so let's get going. You probably just got your kit, you're looking at it and going, how do I do this? So let's talk about the things that are in the kit. first thing you're gonna notice is the Brainy Briny Beaker Bag. This is just a nice poly bag. It's got graduations on the side so you can measure volume, and it's got a 1 millimeter grid so that when you grow your brine shrimp, you can measure how big they are. The first thing you're gonna wanna do when you get this is inflate it. Why do I say inflate it? Because if you try to open it up, sometimes the bottom part, which is what's called gusseted, it's got this little thing that opens up. It doesn't open up the right way, so you gotta do this. You ready? See how it popped open in the bottom? Now this beaker bag is open and ready for business. The next thing that you're gonna wanna do, let me walk through the other parts first. This is algae culture. This is a strain of algae called Nanochloropsis. This microalgae is about two microns in diameter. They're super small in the microalgae world. Bacteria are pretty much the only kind of organism that's going to be smaller than this.
Did my video go off for a little bit? I should never be in charge of technology. I'm going to try this again, okay? It's a good thing I don't get paid for my technology, huh? Sorry, you guys.
Really cool because they're so small, they grow fast. They can get nutrients. Talk about things that are in the kit. First thing you're going to notice is the Brainy Briny Beaker Bag. This is just a nice poly bag. It's got graduations on the side so you can measure volume, and it's got a 1 millimeter grid so that when you grow your brine shrimp, you can measure how big they are. The first thing you're going to want to do when you get this is inflate it. Why do I say inflate it? Because if you try to open it up, sometimes the bottom part, which is what's called gusseted, it's got this little thing that opens up. It doesn't open up the right way, so you got to do this. You ready? Got popped open in the bottom. Now this beaker bag is open and ready for business. The next thing that you're going to want to do, let me walk through the other parts first. This is algae culture. This is a strain of algae called Nanochloropsis. This microalgae is about two microns in diameter. They're super small. And
do you remember that our cysts were 250 microns? So much, much smaller.
Microalgae world. Bacteria are pretty much the only kind of organism that's going to be smaller than this. And these are really cool because they're so small, they grow fast. They can get nutrients really well, really, really well from their surroundings. Now, we actually add nutrients to this container. So all of the fertilizer you need to grow the algae is already right here. So there's no extra stuff that you need to add. Now, this Nanochloropsis is a saltwater loving algae. So it's marine. So what we have here is some seawater salts. Well, and so what you're gonna do is you're gonna add the salts to the beaker bag and then add some chlorine-free water. But the neat thing about these salts is they already have the brine shrimp cysts inside them. Brine shrimp, known as Artemia, Artemia francisensis, or Artemia salina.
Okay, so I just have to correct Matthew there just really quick, because ours are, the ones we're using are Artemia franciscana, in case people are really worried about the taxonomy of these shrimp.
Are little invertebrates that graze on, guess what, the algae. So this is how we get, or those are the tools there to get the algae and the brine shrimp growing in the beaker bag. The last thing here is, this is called a seshi stick. And this seshi stick helps us to quantify how much algae biomass is there. We'll go into that in just a second. Okay, let's pretend that you just got the kit like we did. You inflate your beaker bag. Next thing you're going to do is you're going to take all of your salts here, and you're going to dump the whole thing into the bag. After you've added your salts, go ahead and fill the water up, and we want to get it to about 450 mils, right about there.
Okay, and this is where, if you're working with one of these tissue culture flasks, you only want to add yours up to the 175 milliliter mark. So Erica, if yours says 500 milliliters of water, only put 175 in those. We're actually testing both of these. The reason I gave you two different types is that these ones are, they don't drip water on your desk. And I invited a whole bunch of people from Westminster, and I don't want to get sued for putting it all in. And yes, if you are, if you're working with the tissue culture flask, put the entire bag of salt in that you have. These are made specifically for those. Thank you for that question. And Bonnie Jean Knighton, her flask came broken, and I am really, really sorry. You don't need to use a tissue culture flask. You could just add 175 milliliters of water. Look on, I don't know the conversion to that, but you could just put it in a Kerr jar or anything waterproof that you can shake up. These aren't magic. They're just a vessel for brine shrimp.
I want to fill it all the way up because when you seal it, it'll spill over. And then begin to shake it. The salt should dissolve pretty quickly, but be careful. This, although this top is pretty sealed, it's not a perfect seal with it.
Okay, so we have more questions. If you have your tissue culture flask, I want you to put the entire bag of salt in. I know Angel is here. Angel, I met through kind of my side hustle where I sell the kids book that I have, and Angel bought a bunch of brine shrimp stuff from me. So I'm glad that Angel's here. Angel has a little funnel to use to put the salt in. I'm just gonna like be like a salt cowgirl, and I'm just gonna put it all in just like that and shake it up. So whatever you have in your kit, put into your tissue culture flask, or if you're working with one of the beaker bags, put the entire bag into the beaker bag. And thank you for asking more questions. Keep that up. Keep that up for sure. Okay. So while you're, let's see. Okay. So I'm going to keep telling you a few more things about our wonderful little brine shrimp. So now you're looking at your flask, right? And you're like, it kind of looks like it has like some little dirt. And if you notice, you know, if you, you're going to be shaking it up, but when you stop shaking it, you'll see those cysts. They're going to congregate. They're going to float. They're less dense than the water that we put them in. And they're going to congregate up here. So now we have these cysts that are put in here. If we were to look at these cysts under a microscope, or once they hatch, these little nauplii, they're pretty cool. They're gonna hatch out of these eggs. It'll take about 24 to 48 hours for them to hatch. And then you'll start to see these little baby brine shrimp that are there. They're really, really, really hard to see. If you put them under a scanning electron microscope, you would see something like this. These are the beginnings of their little theracopods, and they use them to move around in the water, very jerky. You'll see them, if you hold them up towards the light, you'll kind of see them. As they get older, they start to get these things kind of akin to gills. These are called theracopods. The theracopods actually, they gather all of the microorganisms that they eat. And then those microorganisms, they're mostly algae. They travel up the midline of their body and into their mouth through this cool countercurrent system. And they just keep getting bigger and bigger. And more developed. This is the head of one of the adult male with these big giant claspers. I think he looks, you know, pretty mean and pretty scary looking. He's still only about this big, so don't worry about him. I actually want to make a call for changing the our mascot at Westminster to the fighting brine shrimp. Right now we're the griffins. I think brine shrimp are kind of cooler. And I also have always advocated for us to put brine shrimp on our state drink of choice. Our Diet Coke shouldn't have polar bears. I think that it should have brine shrimp. But really, like Matthew told us earlier, these brine shrimp are eating microalgae. This is the what I'm showing you on this screen is called Dunaliella viridis. Dunaliella is one of the predominant species in the upper water column at Great Salt Lake. But brine shrimp will eat anything. Really, they have the largest salinity tolerance of any invertebrate. And so they can eat anything in their water. And so right now, we're going to go back and we're going to talk to Matthew about the algae parts. Now, if you think that I'm crazy about brine shrimp, Matthew is crazy about algae like I am about our cute little brine shrimp. And so you can go to Algae Research and see lots and lots of information about these types, about different types of algae and how we think that, they might save the world. I'm just gonna skip ahead a little bit. Can everybody see my screen okay?
Might be able to see some of these guys inside there. Can you see them?
You can see lots of the cysts.
Oh, I did this wrong. I shouldn't be in charge of technology.
That already has the nutrients in it.
Dump your algae in.
There we go. This is now all done. You can save this and use it for other experiments that you want to tinker with in your home laboratory. Just to make sure everything's distributed inside there. You're going to mix that up a little bit, okay? Now, what you're going to want to do is set this in a nice, bright spot. Now, it just so happens I have, as most of you do, right, an LED light right in your home. You want to set this, if you can, about that far away, just off of a bright light. Windowsills are often too bright. We call it a flux of light from the sun. Gives you about 3,000 microeinsteins per meter squared second. And that's just the number of photons per area per time. Fancy way of saying it's a lot of light. Where this is going to give off about 100. Now, this microalgae culture only needs about 100 to grow really, really fast. More than that, and they have to work pretty hard, believe it or not, to get rid of the extra light. So no extra light for these algae cultures. It'll make them work too hard. And it could make the water too hot. Anything over about 100 degrees Fahrenheit is gonna kill the algae. So this is—
Okay, and so Angel is telling us something in the comments too that I really want to highlight. We really wanna shake these every day. That's one of the most important things that I've found is like shaking it every day. When I'm not gonna spill it on my computer, I take the lid off to let some oxygen in there. People that culture brine shrimp and use them as pets will use aeration is very important. So shaking it up every single day, it doesn't have to take forever. Just getting enough so you can mix those gases in. Does it need to be natural light or does the light in my class work? And should I put it near a window instead? So I've found the best way, Erica, is to put it next to a light source. A lot of times classroom, like any kind of light source that you can find, like a desk lamp or anything like that, that it'll warm them up a little bit. They actually like warmer temperatures than our normal 75 degrees. I think they grow best at like 83 degrees Fahrenheit. So if you can put them in a little bit warmer place. And Matt, so I find that shaking them up is a very important part of this. So I'm going to skip ahead just a little bit. I tried to give you a sneak preview.
these guys inside there. Can you see them?
You can see lots of the cysts. There they are. Those are all the brine shrimp swimming around inside there. They're getting pretty big now. And when they go in front of the grid, you can see them and quantify and get an estimate of how big they are.
The last thing that we're gonna do is use the seshi stick. Now this seshi stick is pretty interesting because it's going to help us use a property called optical density to measure how much biomass is inside of the algae culture. So you're gonna take your seshi stick, this is your seshi stick, and you're gonna fold it on the dotted line that's on the bottom of this, right above that little black and white target. Now, that little black and white target is what you're gonna look at. So you are gonna try to put this under the water to the depth at which that target just disappears. So you're gonna go down, up, down, up, down, up, until the very moment.
Okay, Erica, I saw, oh yeah, okay, there you go.
And you can't see it, right? Sometimes if you go back and forth with it a little bit, your eyeball catches it. We as humans, we like things that move, so I like to do that trick a little bit. So I'm gonna push this under the water. I'm old, so I have to take my glasses off now. So I'm sticking underwater, and this culture, I'm gonna move that light out of the way. That's cheating. You wanna do this exactly the same way every time. How's the top of my head look? Is that shiny? Don't let the reflection of my head hurt the camera. This is at 40 millimeters of seshi stick depth. So on your instructions, you'll have a little a graph to show you.
Okay, so now I'm gonna take you, we're gonna go to Great Salt Lake right now. Because this principle of the seshi stick, it doesn't apply just to these tissue culture flasks or in a lab. So these are my friends with the DNR, the Department of Natural Resources Great Salt Lake Ecosystem Program, so that we can connect these two concepts together.
One of the simplest measures that's been used for a while is the Secchi disk. And this is just a measure of water clarity. So in a way, it's a surrogate for how much phytoplankton and algae you have in the water. And this has been around for, I think, a couple hundred years. And it's a universal measurement because a lot of people make this exact measurement on a lot of different lakes, and they've done it for a long time. So the principle is you take a disk of uniform size with this pattern on it, and you lower it through the water column until it disappears. And then you take that depth, and that gives you an idea of how clear the water is. And if people are using the same disc in the same manner at different water bodies over time, you have a very standardized measurement for water clarity. So lower it on a line that has marked increments. And you lower it till it disappears. Right now the lake's pretty clear. In the middle of winter, you'd only be able to see 6 inches or so.
The sun will come through the prism. And it'll tell.
Cool. And then you get this, right? And you, this is from a book that Dr. Bonnie and Baxter and myself have just published. If any of you teachers need it or you're using it for research and you can't afford to buy a $170 book about the biology of Great Salt Lake, I want you to email me and I can send you anything that you want. So know that this is here. But the reason I show this to you, if you follow this green line is essentially how much algae is in the water. And that's the same thing you're measuring with your turbidity stick or your seshi stick. And then notice how these brine shrimp that are in the horizontal bars or the vertical bars, notice how they increase in the springtime. Right about now, they're starting to get a lot of brine shrimp. And once you get both Nauplii, the babies, and the juveniles and the adults all together, they essentially eat eat all of that algae. They filter all of that microalgae out of the water. Some of it's that's very similar to this nanochloropsis that we're using right now. So you get this cool relationship of decreasing algae, increasing brine shrimp. And so those shrimp are turning that algae into biomass. One of the really cool things about Great Salt Lake is there are lots and lots of brine shrimp in Great Salt Lake. I think they're kind of funky. They could be disco shrimp if we keep looking at them at a time lapse. Sometimes the biomass in Great Salt Lake is equal to the biomass in 1.8 million people. So that is truly incredible at one time to have all of that biomass in there for lots of different bird species that are around. Again, I hope that you're having fun. I'm going to check the chat here in just a minute and see if there's more questions for me. You can click on this QR code for any links and resources. You can always email me. I want you to go to greatsaltlakeinstitute.org and look at teacher resources for free curriculum using very easy to find things. And then I just want to thank a whole bunch of people, Matthew and Danielle at Algae Research Supply, that sent out all of these kits and who have created this really awesome kit. Definitely Westminster College supports my job, which I really love. And sometimes I can also get brine shrimp temporary tattoos, which is really cool that we can have those. Rio Tinto funded all of our Brainy Briny kits, so thank you. And then thank you to everybody that's on here. We have over 50 people here, and I'm hoping that I can get your data because I want to make all of this better for the students and teachers that are using these. So thank you so much. I'm going to stop my share now, and I'm going to go to our questions and answers. So Stephanie Hurd wants to know the name of the shrimp taxonomy. I'm going to type the answer when I'm done talking. Heather wants to know, will placing this next to a lighted aquarium tank work? The light is super, super important, and so is the heat. What do you think, Matthew? Do you think that a lighted aquarium tank will work? Do you want to come on here, Matthew? Turn your video on. He might be going to the beach. He's out in California and he warned me he might be going to the beach. So here's Matthew. What do you think? If you place it in a
I think can you guys hear me okay?
Yeah.
Can you hear me all right?
Yeah.
Awesome. I think an aquarium light might not be enough light. They're usually made to not have algae grow inside of your fish tank. So they minimize the flux of photons there. They're usually about, 10 microeinsteins per meter squared second. And you're going to saturate photosynthesis with around 100 to 120. Will a flashlight work? It probably will. Just point it right at it. It depends on how much culture you're going to end up growing. And with this, it'll probably be just dense enough.
One thing you could do, and thank you, Bonnie Jean, for asking this, and thank you for your answer, Matthew, and I'm a little bit jealous about the beach thing. What about a flashlight? Will a flashlight work, Matthew?
Yeah, it probably would. A flashlight would probably be enough light to get on there, but you're going to have to change the batteries all the time, so that may not be the right way to do it. Now, we did have some success up in Tacoma, Washington, where students in fifth grade, they put these in their windowsills inside of a pane glass. So they weren't in light in winter, but it was in sunlight. So it's Tacoma, so they get it's all cloudy. I think in Utah, you guys get a lot of sun. So just kind of if it gets too warm and it looks too bright, it's probably too much. You can always put a little screen in front of it, maybe a paper towel, and that'll mitigate a lot of the light.
And what, do you have any, like, if people are using a desk lamp, what kind of wattage of bulb is the best? Do you have an idea?
Yeah. So with respect to the light, if it's an LED, I would imagine that like 7 watts is about good. If you're going to use a CFL, I think they're about 20 watts. Just one of the screw-in top ones is usually going to be good enough. And if you're going to use a conventional, I wouldn't go above 40 to 60. But be careful of the conventional. They'll melt the plastic, whether you're in the flask or in the beaker bag.
And thank you, Matthew. And do you have how long should they stay near the light? Like, do you do light dark cycles at all?
That's a great question. So all of the academics I've ever worked with have said, oh, you have to give the room to do the dark reactions. And so that's generally been the way I like to operate. And also because, you know, it just makes the whole culture last a little longer. But you can go into 24 hours of continuous light. That shouldn't be an issue. They'll grow faster, definitely, and you'll have more biomass. But I don't know. I like to think of algae as needing a rest every once in a while. I always get accused of personifying them a little bit too much, but I like to give them a little bit of a rest.
And Angel is my friend who has been culturing these brine shrimp, and they're saying that for their brine shrimps, a plant grow LED lamp works like a charm. So, and I know that Angel is growing lots and lots of brine shrimp. Is what I think. Cool. Who does anybody else have more questions? Will you throw them in the Q&A? And so right now, I hope everybody has had so much fun putting these together. I'm going to send out an email once a week. It's a very simple questionnaire that's a form on Google that should take you under 2 minutes to tell us how things are going, any advice that you have, and we just want to collect your data and make these better. So I will send you emails. Matthew, we have one more question. Is Nanochloropsis, this is the species of algae that's in our briny brainy things, is it used for a specific reason, or are other algaes edible for the shrimps?
That's a great question, and you could probably even field that one too. But because I'm on location, I'll talk. So I like Nanochloropsis because it is a great lab rat. It grows really well in captivity, and it doesn't like to grow in any other spaces. So it's not going to be an invasive species anywhere else. And it loves to grow if you can keep grazers away from it. And if you can keep a nice supply of CO2 and sunlight, it's going to grow like gangbusters. You set it free and it's just not competitive. And it's small enough for the mouth parts of the brine shrimp. So I've been growing Nanochloropsis for a little over 10 years, different strains of it. And this strain seemed to really do a good job at feeding the brine shrimp so that they could grow to maturity, as well as providing a habitat. Because it's not just the brine shrimp, like Jamie was saying, or it's not just the algae. The algae die and decompose, so you've got bacteria and fungus in there creating a whole nutrient loop. So you're remineralizing all sorts of stuff, and the brine shrimp poop and everything too. And those all get reused for the brine shrimp as food. But you could use a lot of different microalgae strains. Like Jamie said, in the Great Salt Lake, it is, it's not Artemia, that's the brine shrimp. It is Dinelliella salina, right? Or it's the other Dinelliella.
Yeah, it's Artemia franciscana.
I'm sorry, but the green algae that grows in the Great Salt Lake, that's Dinelliella, isn't it?
Yeah, Dinelliella franciscana.
Oh, okay. And that one in captivity is a little bit more fickle. So I wanted to choose a microalgae that was really robust and would perform for you in your lab / kitchen table every time.
Cool. Peggy wants to know if you document the number of hours of light you are receiving. And thank you, Peggy, so much. I think we'll keep it pretty simple for now, but if you think that your light regime is like perfect, please continue to use that and tell us about it in the short answer part of the survey every week. We would love to know. I do have a question on how to use the Secchi stick that I'd like to answer. So right now I've got my Brainy Briny kit and here is my Secchi stick. Let's see. So here's my Secchi stick right here. And all you have to do is drop this down. So you want this at a right angle. You see how that's at a right angle? And so when I put it into my little Brainy Briny kit, it's going to disappear. When those pie pieces, when those black and white pie pieces disappear, you can mark on the side. So mine's at about 35 millimeters right now, but you'll only be able to see in the water probably between, you know, 30 and 50 millimeters. And that's what you can record. Let's see, so we answered that. What other questions? Oh, I have another chat here. Is there somewhere we can buy more algae if we want to keep feeding them? So the really cool thing is that if your algae keep living, so the way that I see that brine shrimp feed, I see that they feed like this. They're swimming along and eating all at the same time. And anything that goes into their mouth is going, they're going to eat. And so what's going to happen is your algae, there's going to be a population increase in your algae. And then you're going to see a population increase in your brine shrimp. And then you're going to see a population decrease. And so you're going to see this inverse reaction of algae versus of brine shrimp versus the algae, which is really, really, really cool to see. And for all of you teachers, we will be looking at that here in a minute in kind of more details that I thought would be too detailed for all of the other people that are coming. So the short answer is, Monica, you shouldn't really have to get more algae. You should be able to just feed them, but please put them in the questions. If you have questions in our little feedback every week, please ask me. I do have a question about what the pipettes are for. Pipettes are just the coolest thing ever in the history of the world. And so we wanted to give those to you, but you can take these. This is a kit that I started a while ago. You can actually use them to catch these brine shrimp. So I just caught this. You can see this brine shrimp that's not very happy with me that's in my pipette, and you can look at them under microscopes. Maybe you don't have a microscope, use your phone on the macro lens and you can put it on any kind of surface. I just happen to have a Petri dish. You could put it on the Petri dish and use it to take pictures use your phone to take pictures of it. A lot of people worry about hurting their brine shrimp. Like, am I going to hurt my brine shrimp if I shake them up? Remember, they're in Great Salt Lake. They're in nature, and that doesn't seem to hurt them. It mixes the water up. You can see my shrimp that are in here. Some of mine are coupled, and you'll see them mating. You'll see them have babies. You'll see all sorts of cool behavior. You can see these ones in front, those are coupled and they're mating. So I would love to invite anybody who is not a teacher. You can leave if you want to. We would love for you to stay if you would like to stay and listen to talk about standards and curriculum. Please do what you want. I'm going to give us like 3 minutes to kind of get my guests in order right now. We have a few guests that we've been collaborating with. So take a deep breath. If you need to get a drink of water, if you need to go to the bathroom, go do that. We're going to come back in just a few minutes and visit with some people that I work with and collaborate much with. Thank you for coming. If you're taking off right now, thank you for coming. This will be recorded. I will put it on our YouTube channel. If you have questions, I've emailed you about 1400 times in the last few days. I hope you're not sick of me. You know my email address and you can email me questions that you have. My big plan is to put these in classes beginning in the fall. I can't call it BS in the classroom officially, but you all know what I'm thinking when I talk about brine shrimp in the classroom or brine shrimp at home. And so now I hope that Maggie Miller will turn her cameras on and will talk to us about the work we do. So I'm just a biologist, right? I know how to count brine shrimp. I know how to study them. I really like to study birds, but I'm not a teacher. And I really love that I can collaborate with teachers, and it is a true collaboration. So Maggie Miller is from the Murray School District, and I feed her a whole bunch of biology, like boring brine shrimp papers, and I tell her all sorts of crazy facts that she probably doesn't ever want to know about anymore, but I feed her research. And then she takes all of that and puts it into a form that teachers can actually use with free curriculum. So Maggie, will you talk to us about the curriculum that we're, oh, I forgot, while we're doing that, while we're getting ready, I forgot I was gonna do something fancy and I was gonna launch a poll. So right now, for the next couple minutes, there's some questions about, have you taught science standards
before? Can you use that way we can save it until I'm done talking, because the questions will probably make more sense after.
Oh yeah. Yep. Sorry.
Okay. No, that's totally great. Totally great.
Go ahead. Start talking. I'm turning it to you. I'm like done.
Well, I'm going to share my screen if that's okay, just so I can show a few things. Can we see that okay?
Yeah, it's great.
Okay. So, like Jamie said, we're working on creating a curriculum that will feature the Brainy Briny beaker bag specifically for fifth grade. It's going to be a unit and it's going to cover one of the Utah seed standards. And it's like very, very preliminary right now. So I don't even have a name for it yet. So we'll just, the working title can be Energy Matter in the Great Salt Lake. And yeah, I'm Maggie Millar. I'm at Murray School District. I'm at Parkside Elementary. And that's my personal email. Share it again at the end if you have any questions that you think of later or want to follow up about anything. But I just want to take a couple of minutes to show you the standard that this curriculum is going to cover using the bag, and then just kind of describe some of the perks of using it so that you can decide for yourself if this is something you want to plan on using next year. And you can start thinking about that. And so there you go. So the seed standard that this is going to cover is 5.3.2, which says obtain, evaluate, and communicate information that animals obtain energy and matter from the food they eat for body repair, growth, and motion, and to maintain body warmth. And we're going to emphasize that the energy used by animals was once energy from the sun. So as I have been unpacking this standard and really looking at it carefully and parsing out the pieces, I've noticed two things that I think are really can be challenging about this standard. Well, actually three things that can be really challenging about this standard for teachers. So first of all, we just switched to the seed standards, and this standard is unlike any other fifth grade standard we've had in the past. So for one thing, that's the one challenge. It's just unfamiliar. We haven't usually talked about energy and matter and how it cycles through ecosystems in fifth grade before. So it may just be new content for you. But then two big challenges are there's like really sophisticated content in this standard. This talk about energy and matter and cycling through ecosystems, just energy and matter in the life sciences. You're going to have your students come in with what is going to feel like really, really good background knowledge because, well, of course, they intuitively know that when you eat food, it helps you grow and it helps you have energy. But when you dig into this a little further, you realize there's a lot more layers of there are a lot more layers of science ideas that they're going to need to build out, and maybe even that you are going to need to build out. It's just really sophisticated content, and there's multiple entry points. It is hard to decide what order you're going to teach these science ideas in, unlike other standards, which have a more intuitive order sometimes. So it's just it's a challenging standard. And then it's also a research standard. The SCP, the science and engineering practice, is obtaining, evaluating, and communicating information. So this isn't, you know, we may be more familiar with like doing experiments or whatever, but this is a research standard. And it is asking us, like when you go into the Utah core guide for this standard, it's asking us to take multiple complex texts and other media resources and having the students take all those sources and synthesize them to basically derive the science ideas themselves. And I know that for me as a teacher, that has always been challenging because it's so hard to find texts that are really rich in content and are going to meet the standard, but that are also comprehensible for the students that are at their reading level. So I found myself either like creating the sources myself, which is very time intensive and a lot of labor, or compromising on the content, which is also not great. So what we want to give to you in this curriculum is a lot of aid with both of those things, helping you and your students understand the content really well, and then also providing you with really awesome sources that you can just give to the students. So the Brainy Briny Beaker Bag is going to support an anchor phenomenon. We're going to have an anchor phenomenon. I'm not going to give the whole thing away right now, but it does have to do with a lot of the things Jamie talked about at the beginning of the presentation today. And then the Brainy Briny Bag is going to provide the lesson level phenomena, like each day or for each learning episode. So right now I haven't decided. We're still writing this. We're still at the beginning, but this will either take one or two bags for your classroom. It's not going to be like one for each kid or one for each group, unless you wanted it to be. It could be.
Can I break into a little bit? It's actually something that Bonnie Jean Knighton from the Natural History Museum of Utah was putting in the chat that I wanted to really hit with teachers. Is this is really cool to test different variables, maybe.
Yeah, so you could choose as a teacher, like in order to teach this curriculum, you're only gonna need one or two, but you can like totally go crazy with this, right? Sorry, did you have something else? I interrupted you.
No, that's awesome. Great.
Perfect. So that's one thing you're going to get with this. And then the other thing, and the curriculum itself is going to be totally free. So all you'll have to worry about getting is the beaker bags. And then we also are going to be creating text sets and media sets from researchers at the Great Salt Lake Institute. So that you can just, that is going to be comprehensible and complex and have great science ideas in it that the kids can synthesize to obtain and evaluate that reliable science information and build out these ideas and make sense of these ideas. So together, these resources are going to support students in understanding and communicating the role of energy and matter in the bodily functions of animals living in the Great Salt Lake. So like I said, the standard is tricky because other standards, sometimes the science ideas like follow, like there's really only one order you could teach them in, but this one is different. Like there's a million different ways you could start and end with this one. So I'm not going to read this whole slide, but I just wanted to kind of show you, you know, we're going to start with talking about animals get the matter they need from the food they eat. We're going to move into animals also get the energy they need to move from the food that they eat. Again, your kids are gonna be like, I know that, but there's a lot more to it. How is it released? And at what point is it being used by them? And then we're gonna talk about, you know, like matter, energy can't be created or destroyed. So therefore we can trace all of it, all the energy an animal is using back to the sun. And then like, what else do animals use energy for from food? Is it just for movement or is it for other things too? And what happens to it when they use it? Ultimately, all the energy that all animals use to survive comes from the sun. And then at the end, they are going to be generalizing these science ideas to an analogous phenomenon. So these are our best practices. next generation science standard practices of being phenomenon led and starting with an anchor, and there's going to be lots of phenomena, so you don't have to worry about that. So that's really all I'm going to share about that right now, but I just wanted you to, if this sounds interesting to you, like a resource you want to use next year, mark your curriculum maps. We're hoping to have this available at the end of the summer. But then also just keep in mind 5.3.2 is the standard. It's the third to last standard for fifth grade science. So my guess is you probably won't get to it until the third quarter, like maybe not quite a year from now. If you're teaching the standards in order, which hopefully you are. Right now I'm planning on it being about 6 learning episodes, probably about 60 minutes each. That might come out to, I don't know, maybe around 2 weeks of instruction for your average elementary classroom, depending on how much time you have to teach science each day. The students are going to be drawing on ideas from 5.2 and then, of course, 5.3.1. In fact, I think that using your beaker bag, I think there's some really great ways you could use your beaker bag during 5.3.1. So that's definitely something to think about. And this is going to integrate super, super nicely with your reading informational text 5.7 and 5.9, like really nicely, so if you need like a selling point to talk to your administrator about this or anything like that, that's a free one. It's going to be really good. So spread the word if you know any other fifth grade teachers who might be interested in this, to keep your eyes out. It's going to be on the Great Salt Lake Institute website, which I know Jamie shared at the beginning of her presentation. And then she also shared there are sixth grade units there already. And so make sure you tell your sixth grade colleagues too. I didn't write those lessons. So if you want to get a flavor of what this is going to be like, it's not going to be quite the same because it was written by somebody else, but still, I have taught a couple of those units and they are awesome too. So I feel like I had something else, but I don't remember what it was. So again, there's my email address. And if you want to follow up about this in the future, feel free. But also, do we have any questions? I'll stop sharing. Do we have any questions so far?
And I wanted to wait and let all of the people who painfully stayed with us, I hope it wasn't painful. I've had a ton of fun, but I do have extra kits. So when we first started this, I had planned on a bunch of them going to this outreach event, and I think I probably have 50 kits left. So if you have colleagues or if you wanna play around with these in your classroom, you can email me and let me know. I'm typing it right now in the chat, and let me know how many kits you would like, because you're the last people standing, you deserve a present. And I also, I don't see any questions, so I want Paul.
I don't know if now's a good time or not, but I do have that poll.
Thank you. I'm going to do a poll. And while we're doing the poll, hey, Paul, if you want to get your stuff up and running, that would be great. Okay.
This poll is for me to get some information about what your preferences are when it comes to a unit, and some other information I could use as I finish writing this. So.
Did you know there was somebody here from Australia that I think is really, really, really awesome? I hope you had so much fun. I'm going to let this poll, if you're still with us, you can quickly answer this poll. I'm going to leave it going for about another
40 seconds. And Jamie, will you be able to like send me the results? Or okay, perfect. That's it for me then.
Cool. I just want to show you what a nerd I am while we're doing this. There was a... I don't think you just need to do science with Brine Shrimp. So this is my Brine Shrimp hand puppet. It came from Puppets in the City and Shelby Rickert. I'm not a ventriloquist either. And was in a play called Singing with the Brine Shrimp with Plan B Theater. I don't have any of the, this is a kind of a special thing that I just wanted to like have fun. during this program, playing with my brine shrimp. But there's lots of other fun, cool ideas that I think that teachers could bring into lesson plans that aren't just science, that are involve art and theater. And we've talked about math, we've talked about lots of things. So Paul, if you wanna start sharing, I'm gonna leave the poll up. And I'm bringing Paul Wisman. He was a Westminster student. I'm really, 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 really stoked that I get to still work with students. Paul works at the Natural History Museum of Utah and is going to tell us about some cool things that the Natural History Museum is doing.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks, Jamie. I just have two resources that I wanted to share with everyone real quick. So at the museum, we normally have like field trips and we go out to visit schools, but with everything going on this year, we had to kind of adjust. So the first one I'm going to share with you all is a part of our virtual field trip. So I'm going to share it in the chat for you and then also screen share so you can kind of follow along. So our virtual field trip basically focuses on the major migrations of the Great Salt Lake in our Great Salt Lake exhibit. So that's the link I just shared with you in the chat. What we have here is a really cool way to explore our exhibits at the Natural History Museum of Utah. There's a few videos on the floor of our exhibit where we have some educators like myself and my friend Annie who are describing some of the materials. And then there's even activities for your students to explore. We talk about how the lake levels change, the migratory birds, and even the people living around the Great Salt Lake for thousands of years. So that's really awesome. We had a series of Q&As with some really awesome folks that you can also check out that are kind of separated by grade level. So if you are teaching a certain grade, you can check out our Stay Curious Utah videos, which were recorded this past year. And that's a really cool resource to get integrated with like our exhibits and see what we have going on with the Great Salt Lake and there. The other thing that I wanted to share with you all is a brine shrimp adaptation kit. So we have sort of along the same lines of like these kits that we were working with today, but the museum, we have them all, they're all like sold out right now. Or when I say sold out, I mean, they're free for teachers, but we ran out of them. So if you would like a similar type of kit, we offer basically, let's see if I can show you guys. There's some really cool maps that we have that we send out to you, as well as these really big algae wafers, which are a lot different than the other ones, and a giant pack of brine shrimp eggs, as well as some activities. So these kits, if y'all are interested, we will be, you can sign up on this email list right here. And then you can basically get them sent to you from us here at the museum. But we have, as well as the kits, some more videos specifically about brine shrimp and the brine flies, which is really fun to see their life cycle. And then there's the PDFs of all the stuff that's included in the kit. So I just realized I was screen sharing while I was showing the stuff in the lab. But those are our two main resources right now that are available for teachers that you can access on our website. I will drop this other link in the chat for you all. And then, yeah, I have maybe one more thing to share that's really cool. Just if anyone is interested, we're also doing some virtual classes, but we're doing adaptations mostly now in this lab. If y'all wanted to see our little tank in the back, we have some cool birds to share with you. But we have an avocet, and I think, Jamie, you were talking about this one earlier, but there's a lot of little guys that are just going wild since it's been warmer, I think. And then, yeah, that's all I have to share, I'm pretty sure.
Cool, thank you so much.
Yeah.
I know that some links have been put in by Bonnie and Paul at the Natural History Museum. And if you have any questions, maybe Paul, you could throw your email in the chat.
Definitely. I will put that in right now.
Yeah, that would be really cool. Now, do we have any other questions that we can answer while people are live right now? Because if not, I think that everybody should go and hang out with their Brainy Brine Shrimp and eat dinner with your people and let us know if you have any questions. I know there's a question about how much these are going to cost. We haven't worked out the cost yet, but next year we plan on donating kits to all fifth grade classes in the Salt Lake District, and we're looking for more money so that we can donate those to more fifth grade classes. But if you are a high school teacher, like the person that asked me the question, we would welcome your interest also and would imagine that we can come up with a way to donate those to your class. After this webinar, probably tomorrow, I will send an email out with all of the links to the videos. I'm going to send out links to all of their resources. Somebody wanted to have all of the slides. I can send you the slides that you can use in your classes. And just let me know if you have any questions. Again, this is a beta test and you're helping me. The feedback that you're providing us in the chat function by the feedback you're going to send to us in our Google documents, you are helping us. So thank you so much. Angel, I'm going to be in touch with you, I'm sure, about how to keep these little creatures alive and flourishing and in subsequent webinars or information, we'll ask Angel to help us with your expertise. So thank you, everybody. Thanks for caring about Great Salt Lake. And I hope that by this time next year, our state crustacean will be Artemia franciscana. That would be really cool. Bye, everybody. I love this. Email me if you have ideas. Awesome.